working all the time. And, you know, that's all I can do is think. And I'm always thinking and listening, trying to get some insight on life. Tonight we want to be talking about, again, I don't just teach this because I think that we are dumb. I'm not teaching because I don't think we know anything. But I do believe that the time has come that we must really, honestly, sincerely look at ourselves. Because now I realize one thing, there is nothing wrong ever with God, ever. Yep. Now, I do believe there are certain keys. One of the keys I do believe in all of this is, at the end of the day, you have to remember one thing. I was created for His purpose. Okay? That is very important. And guess who knows your purpose? Right. Guess who is the only one that knows your purpose? All right. So now, with that in mind, I know that Jesus is the only one that knows my purpose. What should I do? What you think? What would you do? If you knew he's the only one that knew it, would that be the one you talk to? Right. Okay. See, that's real simple. That's what I'm saying. This is very simple. Because 99.9% of Christian people that live in the kingdom of God live with absolutely no purpose. I could ask, I'm not going to even ask tonight. I don't want you to take a test. I don't even want you to nod your head and say amen. But if you had to tonight, could you say that I am in the purpose of God and have the assurance that you're in His purpose? Or would you be one of those that says, I don't know what God is doing? I really don't know what God is doing. Can somebody tell me what God is doing? I mean, this is, the reason I'm saying this tonight, because I've been listening to people. And I come to this terms that our problem is, everybody want to have a purpose that's been defined by somebody else's idea of what God wants to do with you. And so we wait not to know what His real purpose is, but we desire to have someone say and agree. And like if I said, you know, I'll be my purpose today is to be a pastor. I get some amens on that, see. But how many of you know that's not my purpose? Uh-oh! Boy, it got so quiet right now in here, red run across cotton. I said, how many of you know, though, that was not my purpose? Now it really got quiet. Because now you're saying, well, Brother Wilson, you're pastoring, and that's not your purpose? No. The purpose was just a part of the process. This pastoring is a part of the process. But there's a greater purpose than me preaching to you. Because most people want to find something to do and call that the total purpose of God when it's only just a process. Let's read. This is very important. Because a lot of times, you know, I know that most people will pray more about the process of God than the purpose of God. First thing we pray, God, what are you calling me to do? He ain't calling you to do anything. He's calling you to be something. His purpose is not in your doing. His purpose is in your being and becoming. Let's look here. Let's read 2 Timothy chapter 1, beginning at verse 7. Sometimes you need to slow down and read these scriptures now. All you Bible scholars, and let's slow down and read them. For God has not given us spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. Now, even in that alone, we do see some purpose there. Now, I know if I'm fearing, I know that's not. Right? If I'm going crazy, what is that? Okay, so we know that. So what do you do when you feel like you're going crazy? Go more crazy? What do you do when you catch yourself in a state of fear? Get more scared? Just talking. Don't worry about it. Like I said, these questions I'm asking, you don't have to answer, because you're going to have to answer them to you and not to me. All right? Be not therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner. Now, reading that lightly and slowly, just reading that, here's Paul. Because if I had a ministry like Paul, liberating ministry, I'd have a hard time calling myself a prisoner. But he said, be not ashamed of the testimony of Christ. Now, what kind of testimony does this guy have? One of them went like this. Every time he went to a town, there was a riot, and he got his head combed. But it was a testimony. How many whoopings could you take before you realize it was a testimony? Huh? How many times would you have to get whooped and then turn around and get back up and go to the next town? How many times will we have defined what we are doing to become the purpose of God and quit because the process was too rough? Because what would happen if we got beat up everywhere we went and go preach? Is one or two things going to happen. We'll either quit preaching or be very selective. You ain't got too many choices. So here's Paul. He says, but be not therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but he be thou partakers of the affliction of the gospel according to the power of God. You mean the gospel can afflict you? You mean to tell me Paul is saying it's good news. You're carrying good news. And the good news you're carrying can afflict you. Bible says, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our, y'all on the same page with me? Just go ahead. I just want to make sure we're reading it together. That's why I keep slowing down. I see y'all thinking slow, so I'm talking slow. You know what I'm saying? No, I wasn't having no trouble. I was having trouble hearing y'all. So I thought I was by myself here for a minute. Let's go back there again. Who has saved us? Now look at that ED. Saved us. You see that? So now, his purpose is already there. He has saved us and called it. Here's somebody saying, I'm waiting on my calling. No, he's already called that. So now, he says, and with a holy calling, not according to our works. Oh, he didn't call us according to that? Are you telling me my works is not his purpose? Is that what you're telling me? Is this what he's saying to me? Now watch this. Because most of us feel like our works is our purpose. But he didn't call you according to your works. See, I tried to get God to make me an evangelist one time. Because I was doing the work. And I just knew his purpose for me had to be that. You know why? Now, many of you right now, I know you're not going to say this, but, you know, a lot of times we look at what we really got to offer God and make that the real purpose of God. You know, if I can cook good pies, that means put me on the kitchen committee. If I have a couple of scriptures, give me a job. Let me teach. Let me do something. And so we want to make that our definition of our purpose. And so we just take and embrace all of that. And, you know, don't get me wrong. I desire. Yeah, I do desire to preach the gospel. I want to be a preacher. I love to preach. I love to teach. I love it. But I know that ain't my purpose, not my purpose. That's just a part of my process. Because it says, but according to his own, not according to our works, but according to what? His own purpose and grace, which was given us in, after we got saved. You mean to tell me he had a purpose before I even got here? You mean to tell me I've been here struggling, trying to work myself into his purpose, and all the while his purpose was before I even got the process? Man, y'all so quiet now, I love it. I finally realized, looking at everything, trying to put everything in perspective, I ask myself all the time, because see, I want to know him. And say, I can't even know my purpose if I don't know it. All right. See, God doesn't use a mediator to tell you when he wants to talk to you. Did you know that? Do you ever think about that? He doesn't use somebody else to come tell you what he's going to do with you. That's why when people used to come to me, when I first got in church, man, I'd have been a pastor a year and a half in the church if I would just listen to people. Because they made that my ultimate goal. Man, you better get up. God wants to use you. Look, let me tell you something. God ain't trying to use you. He's trying to process you. There's a higher calling than preaching. Keep, stay with me. Stay with me, boy. I got your attention. That's all I want. Praise God. Whether I got it good or bad, I got your attention. That's all that matters right now. I am so consumed with realizing about the purpose of God. See, we have gotten bogged down in so many things that will never lead us to his true purpose that he has for you. And you got to ask yourself, what purpose do you have for me, God? But we're going to find it in scriptures. Now, I'm going to try to show you in the word of God what his purpose is. Versus what everybody else is saying you need to do, you ought to do, and all that. And when you get through doing all that, you still have not fulfilled his purpose. We struggle with the process, and we become unfruitful. Because there is a real key to all of this. I sat down thinking the other day, the restoration, God keeps bringing me back about his salvation, which talks about restoration. Where does God want to restore me to? Where does he want to bring you to? See, some people thought God wanted to restore them back to church. He wanted to restore them back to church because there was a time when there was no church. There's something way before church. There was a time when there was no buildings. There was a time when there was no such thing as going to church. There was a time when God had a purpose. And he would walk with man. How often? For real? Well, let me ask you one question. How does he live in us and we think he ain't even with us? Why is it that I won't say every Christian, but I will tell you the vast majority of Christians do not realize his restoration was not a weekly thing. It was a daily thing. Because you will never, ever fulfill his purpose without a daily walk. And if my walk is every seventh day, I'm going to miss his purpose. You know, I found out something today, even more stronger than that. What is it that they lost in the garden that we're having trouble getting back now? You know what they had in the garden when they first started was assurance. They were assured of everything. You know why they had the assurance of God? Because daily they walked with him, and daily every need was met. They was assured of something. It wasn't until someone made them doubt that they no longer was assured of God. It was when they doubted God, somebody told them that God lied or something. That's just like when you ask somebody, you know, are you perfect? No, I ain't perfect, but no, we don't answer from where we see it. God, if his purpose was for your perfection, guess what? You better start believing. I am what? I am perfect in him. And the only way I'm not perfect in him, I got to step outside to find imperfection. Because in him, my life is hid. The blood covers and the blood cleanses. How often? How long? How many? Is there a certain day of the week the blood starts working? As long as I am in him, his blood will continually cleanse me. Well, praise God in him. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So we're going to turn to Ephesians. Many of us today, we're so busy trying to work on the process. We're missing the purpose. The main thing. I think it was one of our fellow ministers used to say, keep the main thing the main thing. Well, sometimes we get off on the not so main things and spend so much time that we're wore out that we never get to the main thing. We're going to look in Ephesians chapter 4. Praise God. I almost can say it's warm tonight. Thank you, Jesus. I ain't mad. I am not even mad. I hate cold. Yes, I do, Lord. I do. I do not like it, but I will take it. Read chapter 4. Let me see here. How far do I want to go? Let's start. Let me just begin reading in verse 4. I therefore, the presence of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. with all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the peace in the bond of peace. We know this is part of the process. This is part of your process here. It's part of you. This is some of the things that you need to do. And one of the hardest things to do is to do it when nobody else is doing it. You ever notice that? We ain't going to do it because ain't nobody else doing it. Well, they ain't walking lowly. I ain't walking lowly either. They ain't walking in love, so I ain't walking in love either. But see, this is very personal to you. If you want to get where God's trying to get you, you got to let the word become real to you. Not somebody else's word real to you, but the word of God in your own heart has to become real. Walking in love, walking in lowliness of the mind, walking in this. This is what it says. There is how many bodies? One. There's just one body. That's what I don't understand, man. How many of y'all hate y'all eye? Huh? Your finger will make you mad and you break it. You ever get a pain in your leg and just start beating it to death with a baseball bat? Because you're unhappy with it? You don't? Here's what gets me. As simple as this is, real simple, if there is but just one body, just one. I had a hangnail today. I should have chopped my fingers off. You know why? That's the way we treat each other. You feel like a hangnail. I'm just going to chunk you. No. When we get in a place where we believe that there is but just how many? Amen. That's no more saved body. You know, every one of y'all is a part of the process to make up that one body. And you know what? You know what God used to help you fit into that body? Huh? Man, he has a way. You know what's really bad is when you're in the body and not know where to fit. Because your idea of the purpose of God is different than his process. I'm not just talking about fitting into the body, but first thing I need to get is in him so that he can place me in the body as it has pleased. How many? God is not trying to see if he can put you here to please you. I'm in the body so I can please him. Oh, praise God. Help me, Jesus, tonight. One body, one spirit. We even have people talking about other people's spirit. You're talking about, well, they got a demon. I don't want to say you got a demon. I don't want to say that. Because I don't believe if you got the Holy Ghost, you possess one. I can say this, you may be influenced a little bit by anything. You can be influenced by any spirit. Amen. All you got to do is watch some bad TV and get influenced. Go kill somebody if you can. Keep watching. You understand? But I'm not believing you possess. But I do know we can be influenced. And if we're not walking in heart, in harmony, with our hearts knitted to the heart of God, it's very easy for us to veer off the mark, get over into ourselves and not realize that that is not going to please God. You can only please him in him. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in you all. If we could just even take the time in a week's time and just take this here along and understood just what we just read. At the top of our line, we got one God, and yet we still struggle with trying to figure out how he's one. We need to know. How are you going to know? No man knoweth the Son, save the Father. Nobody knows the Father, save whom the Son would reveal. So we need to spend some time with somebody. If they know it, where should we be? You can't buy enough books to learn about God. I'm going to tell you that now. You can get a lot of information about God, but you cannot buy enough books to know God like you need to know him. Because the only way you're going to know him, he's going to do a download in your system. Before the Bible was, men knew God. Sister Creed's God. But here it says, but unto every one of us is given. Now read this real slow now. Read this real slow. Let's read this. I love this. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure or the gift of Christ. This here should tell you, I don't want to do nothing in God without his grace. If God, see, ain't no sense me complaining to him if he called me and gave me the gift to pastor, I shouldn't complain. You know why? Because along with that gift, he gave me the grace to do it. We suffered back in 90s and 80s. We had what they call a lot of ministerial burnouts. And now I look back on that, and the reason why a lot of time we have those burnouts is because somebody was probably trying to steal a gift that didn't have the grace for it. And if you try to operate in something that God hasn't given you the grace to operate in, you don't get wore out. You don't have to make yourself anything if you let God begin to process you into his purpose. At the end of the day, he has a real purpose that supersedes all this stuff that we're doing. Wherefore he said, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive, gave gifts unto man. Now that he ascended, what is it but he that also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that ascended is the same also that ascended up far above all the heavens, that he might feel, that he might feel all things. All things. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. Now, you remember I told you? That's not a purpose. The ministry was for part of the process. That was just part of the process. That was not him allow me to minister his word. It's not the total purpose of my life. That was part of the process to bring others into his purpose. Well, here we go. For, here it is. Why? Take control or perfect? Be Lord over. See, somehow or another, this got all messed up. Because I don't know how many times I've seen this really messed up. I've seen the one who called himself an apostle felt like he had ascended higher than Jesus. He demanded more worship than Jesus did. He became so he thought that his call to apostleship was God's total purpose for his life. And what happens when you miss the purpose? You pervert everything God gave to this world to make it perfected, to perfect this world within. The ministry is not about how great the apostle or the pastor, the evangelist, it's not how great they are, but what they were put in for is the process of perfecting other saints. For what purpose was that? What was it for that for? Why you need perfecting? When this thing is done like it should be done, is that every time we are ministering to people, we're not trying to turn people on to us. I don't care what, how good we are or how good we think we are. Our whole mission in ministry is for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of ministry. You see, that's why you should never be intimidated or afraid. I would to God that y'all would know everything that was to know in this book. You know why? I still know there's still more to know. Let me keep reading here. And then it goes on. He gave some apostles, some prophets. I'm wearing my glasses at. Mm-hmm. Ooh, thank you, Jesus. Phew. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body. Whew. Who know what edifying mean? Huh? Say it real loud. Now, if you don't have any kind of ministry at all, you got that one. I ain't going to say this because I know y'all all edify each other. Aren't you? Aren't y'all running around trying to figure out just how you can lift each other up? Huh? Aren't we? We're not running in. And then you'll say you have a ministry, but my ministry is for none other reason than to lift up someone else. My ministry, or the ministry God has given you, is not to put you on top. Did you know that? How many of us thought, boy, if I just got to be one of the greatest preachers like T.D. Jakes, get ready, that put me on the top. But Jesus' ministry is not Babylonish, it's not Egyptian. The greatest ministry in this kingdom is at the bottom. And the more grace God gives me, the more I'm able to edify you, to lift you up. Why do I want to lift you up? Because when I lift you up, you're going to help somebody else be lifted up. And when you get a whole bunch of people running around talking crazy to each other, lifting each other up instead of tearing them down, now you'll see the kingdom of God begin to abound in the earth. It's not who's great. There ain't but one great in the kingdom. One. And he lends us. You hear me? He imparts, lends us his ministry. That's why if you get a chance to minister, you ought to be thanking God because, you know what? He allowed me to use that. That's his. Oh, God. But it was till we all and of the knowledge unto the measure of the stature. You mean all this preaching and all the teaching and all this, when we get through edifying all that, he still had one plan, one purpose. Till we all. Unity and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ unto that statue of the fullness of Christ. Somehow, maybe some of this got lost in the translation. I don't know. That somehow we have the process and the purpose of God so closely related that somehow we have not separated the two and realized that they are not the same. They're not the same. You know, we can say, for instance, if David would have been like us and he had learned how to play the harp, killed a couple of bears, lions and things, He could have really relegated himself and said, you know what? I see what the purpose of God is. He just wants me to sit out here and strum this harp and kill some lions and bears. I'm good at it. That's just a part of the process. And then when he killed that giant, he could really quit, because most of us. Can you imagine the day? Big old, what's that big old thing called? Bigfoot? Sasquatch. Shows up downtown, everybody's scared half to death, and you get your little sling out and rock him. You probably start saying, pass not cards. I'm a Sasquatch killer. You know, I mean, really, y'all laughing, but I'm serious. It's that what happens, a lot of times we do one good thing and we think from that one good thing was the whole purpose of the whole life. He had no idea. He kills that thing, kills that big old giant. He's moving up, though. And when he got to the palace, he could have very well stopped and said, you know what? I found my purpose. I'm in royalty, living in the king's house. But that was just part of the process. Then he got crowned one time. It was just part. See, God had a greater purpose for David than what you see. That's why this kingdom is so important. You need to study the kingdom of God, and not just study the kingdom, but you need to study the kingdom, not just in the New Testament, because it's all throughout the Old Testament too. You just don't see it, but it's in there. You know, because David, believe it or not, his kingdom was a separate kingdom than that of Moses in one sense, in that David had a real presence of God and Moses did. Moses' church did. Moses, those people in Moses' temple had learned how to make that their purpose. They really felt like that was the total purpose of God. That's why they really got upset with Jesus when he started messing with it. But see, here was David. Now here, he in a process. He's still part of the process. God interjects a kingdom right in the middle of all that law and all that stuff. Here David got stuff going on, and I'm sure those people at the church over there saying, man, the Levites were saying, man, David ain't right. He can't be right, because God called us to kill these dead animals. Well, they didn't understand David wasn't killing animals, because David knew the process into the presence of God was going to come from killing animals. Somewhere in David's life, he had a revelation. Is that praise and worship invited God in. All they're doing, all that stuff, never feeling God, never knowing anything about God, just busy working the process, which they had called their purpose. Bible says that when we look at the giftings of God, I think I told you before what apostle means, you know, he's one who is sent. It's like he becomes a foundation layer. He lays a foundation. That's why the Bible talks about is that this gospel, this foundation, this is built upon other prophets, apostles, and Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone. So you see, in the foundation of the church, there has to be an apostolic ministry, because that's foundation land. All praise God. In the prophets, they have visions. They can impart words, exhortation, and again, go into the New Testament. There's a different prophetic calling. There's a different prophet calling than it was in the Old Testament. If you look under here, when they prophesied, you know what it should be prophesying for what? For edification. Oh, well, let's go. Some of y'all look at me like it's not in the Bible. Let's go over here because I've been hearing these guys, these prophets of doom, and I'm trying to figure out what spirit is that because it can't be of God. Hello? Can't be of God. Because if he called you as part of the process into this purpose here, then I know then he didn't give you a make a profit out of you to damn the world. So what we need to look at, not what others say, let's look into the word of God. What is it? Okay, I see here. About the gifts here. To another, verse 12, 1 Corinthians 12 and 10. I don't think I went far now. I went too far. It's going to be May 14th. I'm sorry. Okay, here we go. 14. I'm sorry. Of course, then 14 comes out 13, that love chapter. But 14, 1 Corinthians 14. Let's begin at verse 1. Following after charity and desire spiritual gift, but rather that you may prophesy. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understands him. Howbeit in spirit he speaketh mystery. But he that prophesies speaketh unto men. Let's say that again. Let's say it 1, 2, 3. But men to edification, exhortation, and comfort. I've seen a lot of them that didn't exhort and then comfort. But he's telling me that spirit, he gave these gifts into this body so that when these gifts are in operation, is that this what we should be getting from those gifts? Oh, praise God. He that speaketh in unknown tongues edifieth himself. Edifies him. Who? You want to build yourself up? Huh? How do you build yourself up? Speaking in tongues. Right? You pray, building up yourself in the most holy faith. How? He says here, men who speak in unknown tongue edifies himself. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I didn't believe that when I first came into the church. I did not, matter of fact, I'll be honest with you. I got the Holy Ghost on May the 28th, 1978. It took me so long to get it that when I got it, I wiped the sweat off my forehead. I said, shoo, I ain't got to do that no more. I remember Brother Hightower, Moses Hightower came and preached. He preached a message I can never forget as long as I live. Shame is dead. And what I was experiencing, because I didn't feel adequate. You know, you come into a tongue talking church and everybody's just rolling stuff off their tongues and like they done rehearsed that at home. And I didn't feel like I had that. And so I wouldn't speak in tongues. I wasn't about to speak in tongues so you can go and laugh at me. It's almost like they messed me up in dancing too. Same thing. Seemed like everybody that danced in church had been practicing. I ain't lying. You don't just get them steps that easy like that. I mean, they could do it. And it always brought them down front where they could really get it. I'll be back there just trying, on the back of the pew, trying to learn. I'm seeing that. I better not do that. Better not get out there and make a fool of myself. I'm just telling you. Now, I know some of y'all laughing, but that's where I found it. Ain't no way. Man, the way they were dancing so pretty, and I'm going to get out here and do what? Huh? I was scared they're going to break out in a chicken or something. I just coming out the world. But anyway, I remember that night, and part of the reason why I did not really speak in tongues like that? Because I was ashamed. Just keep looking this way. Don't worry about it. I was ashamed to do it because I was afraid somebody might hear me and they're going to critique. You know, church is too bad. We critique too much. Instead of, the Bible said edify. And I found out this. I went to work that night. I danced for the first time. I danced all night that night. I remember Sister Ewan. She's gone now. I remember shaking her hand. I don't know what got on me, man. I don't know what I was doing, but I was doing something. I just felt good. I just felt shame was gone. The whole church was, that's the first time I ever seen the whole church dance. We had a time that night. We even smelled like we'd been to church when we left. So we danced and shouted, and I went home. I spoke in tongues that night for the first time out loud in front of the whole church. I was released. So I got to work, and I worked around these great big old Alice Chalmers motors, and they was making all that noise. So I said, well, man, you know what? I'm just going to do this all night long. I spoke in tongues all night, every chance I got. And the more I spoke in tongues, the better I felt. I seemed like I just got stronger and stronger. And then I finally realized something. You know what? The thing that we need to do, we don't do, the devil's cheating us. Yeah, we're back to shame. I am not ashamed to be who I am. Why should I walk around here down when I know what to do to get edified? Huh? I can't be ashamed of what God has placed in my heart. I sat down one day in a church, I ain't called a name, but you know, I was that black sheep of the family around here. And I was in here and all these other guys were the same persuasion. They knew I wasn't, and so they decided they wanted to jump on me. Oh, man. Oh, so y'all be a jabbering going on. I said, well, if that's what you want to call it. I said, but I read it in the Bible. They did it in there. I don't know why you wouldn't want to. They're trying to cut me down because I spoke in tongues because I believed in it. I ain't ashamed of this. I'm not ashamed of my salvation. I'm not asking you, I'm not talking to you in the first place. What did the Bible say? The man who speaks in an unknown tongue, and who is he talking to? So do you need to understand me when I'm speaking tongues? Huh? No, because I'm not talking to you. That's probably what makes most folks mad, because they don't know what you're talking about. I don't know what that meant when he said that. Okay. But anyway, so I had nothing to do. I found that there are keys in this thing that can build you up. But in the process of building yourself up, I know another key to building yourself up when you build other people up. Make the other guy's stuff better than yours. Lift them up. Build them up. Praise God. Well, anyway, that's enough of that about the prophets. I just thought I'd throw that in there. It didn't cost you nothing. But then he talked about the evangelist, which is going, ability to go and draw, to have that type of message that draws people as an evangelist. And, of course, today we relegate evangelism to strictly a building. But when evangelists first started, it was street. You just started on street corner, you just started preaching. And as you preached, people came, and you kept preaching, things happened. Because that don't happen no more. Because now, no, keep on, leave it alone. Pastors caring, concerned for others, imparting, feeding. That's his real process, is to feed. One thing about if I'm a pastor, I want to feed, but I got to be fed too, though. Yeah, I have to eat. So, well, bro, when do you eat? Every day. I kept God to his word. He said, give us this day, I want daily bread every day. I want to get fed every day, some daily bread every day. Give me some bread every day. So we got the teachers teaching doctrine, lessons. But then again, none of these things really work. You really can't teach doctrine till we know doctrine. See, what it all boils down to is this. There was a young man in the Bible, and they were, I can't remember which story it was, but they had two young men. They had a battle going on, and the king was not certain of what was going on. He sent some messenger. One guy, he could run faster, so he took off just running. He could run faster. He had faster legs. You know, sometimes we think God should have chose me because I talk better, look better. He said, because he was, you know, physically speaking, he was probably the best man for the job because he could get there a lot quicker. But he was the fastest, but he didn't have comprehension. He couldn't retain. He could run fast, but he couldn't keep in memory what he saw. He ran so fast, he got there, he probably was just blowing and can't wait to get back to tell the master, I've been there and back. But the master said, well, what's going on? He said, I won the race. It's not to the one who run the fastest. And many of us think we're getting there before everybody else. It's not if you get there first. He came back. King said, what's going on? Oh, you wanted me to see what's going on? I thought you wanted me win the race. And there's a lot of people today thinking they're winning the race. The race is already won. He came back, he had no idea. And you know what the master said? Stand aside. Don't anybody make you angry that you done been running. I'm running for my life. 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 Did anybody ask you? I'm not going to ask you. But probably if you're running for your life, you probably, when he gets, they're going to ask you, well, what do you guys say? I was running. You don't run for your life. Where'd you get that at? You ain't running for your life. If you're running, matter of fact, this is not a run. Walk. And the just shall run or walk. Ain't that something? All them songs we be singing, I'm running for my life, that's not even in the Bible. He ain't asked you to run nowhere. You run the race? No. They all ran. Only one get the prize. But he really wants you to walk in this. Just walk. Oh, I don't run for my life. I have to believe. I think that's in the Bible. Do you get life by running for it, or do you get it by believing? Huh? Then I need to change my whole concept about me running. Maybe I need to stand still and see the salvation of God a minute. Maybe I'm running too fast. It's almost like the man in the book of Revelation, John. Anytime you have to look back, it means that you got ahead. So if I'm looking back to find God, it means I must have got ahead of God. But what really happens in life is that process determines, purpose determines our process. Your whole life, not since you came to church, from the day you was born, your purpose, your process, your purpose have determined the process with God with you. We all didn't come from the same place. Everybody here would have a different story and a different testimony right now. We all had a chance to give our testimony. There's places you've been, I've never been. Places some of us been, we could never dream of going. See, I believe my purpose is just to hang on till Jesus come. You know what that creates in me? Selfishness. People say, well, I hope I'm just hanging on. Hope I make it in. Make it into what? My daughter was telling me about a lady who came to our church and preached. And everybody was saying where they got to go. When I get there. Where is that? Because the Bible tells me in this walk, we go from faith and glory to glory. So when you get where? I mean, where are you trying to go? Because he tells me you're going to be in this walk here, you're going to be going from faith to faith and glory to glory. So where am I trying to go? I'm just going to the next level of faith. Where am I headed? Next level of glory. Now, how often is it going to happen? I have no idea. But every day I want to go from faith to faith. Oh, when we get there. No, you better know you need to be realizing where you're trying to go. You're there. And then you need to take where you are right now and go from there to the next one. Because what God is trying to do in you is not try to get you so weak that all you can do is hang on. We got to get a new assurance in God. We ain't just hanging on. God don't have nobody just barely making it. How can you barely make it when you got him in you? He has given you all power over all the works of the devil. So why are you just holding on? What's keeping you back? You can't blame the devil. Can you? Oh, the devil's stopping me. That's a lie. Because if I am exercising what he said he put in me, I ain't going to ever tell you the devil's holding me back. Because I realize one thing in this here, we have been made to be more than a conqueror, right? Is that the Bible? Now, how do you think God feels when you get up and start testifying your life? I can't make it. Y'all pray for me that the devil quit whooping me. I'm afraid they whoop you till you get mad enough to whoop him back. See, my mama didn't take that. My mama, when I was growing up, I come in there crying, talking about I just got to whoop it. I remember one time, man, them boys whooped me down there. And I had to run home. My mama chased me right back out. You better go back there and get them if you don't want to face me. I went down and got with it. You know why? Same thing with God. You're sitting there asking God to do stuff right now in your life that really he's not going to do because he's already gave you to do. You understand? You're asking for stuff that he's asked you, why are you crying to me? Why are you crying to me? Why are you crying to me? When I baptized you in my spirit, I gave you everything that you would need, not only in this life, but in the life to come. I loaded you up with every weapon, peace, joy, love, whatever you need. It's that. But what has happened is that we don't understand the process because we'll look at, as I see Brother Creed, God's processing him through $1.5 million. He processed me through five today. I want to say, well, he got $1.5 million. I got five. Well, I'm in the process too. Maybe I'm going to get that too one day, but right now I'm in the process of five. It might be that God wants to test you in the small stuff first before you can give you greater things. So don't look at someone else's process. Don't look at their process and try to make it your process. Don't look at their process and try to define your purpose according to their process, right? I don't understand, you know, and it's hard for us sometimes to understand why God would do what he does, you know. Give you a king like Saul so he can throw javelins and kill you and all that kind of stuff. Throw stuff at you. It don't make sense to do it. It's kind of strange how, boy, see, when he really loves you, he hurts you. Do it. Oh, just me? He's always making me go back on my word. I'm learning as I get older, quit opening your mouth. Just be quiet. Don't say nothing. Because the moment you get them start talking or open your mouth too much, you're going to get in trouble. Don't ever ask me again. Guess what? They ask me again. Why are you doing that, God? Because I have a purpose for you. See, some of us think the purpose of God is for us to be good human beings. And so we work on that. We work on being good human beings. You see, if that's why I have to be so careful. I have to realize the process that I'm in. Because I know if it were left up to me, if I could make everybody do what I think they need to do, I'd be making it. And sometimes in that, it's hard for me because in my process, see, I have to, there's a desire in me to know. There's a desire in me to not want to be average. I have a desire. I tell you, I believed in Santa Claus for a little while, but I've been believing in Jesus a lot longer. But once I found out Santa Claus was not real, guess what? I tore his page out in my book. I didn't go back and try to rewrite a new page and try to make him quasi-real. Jesus, he has showed me just enough to make me believe that he's really, really real. No, I said really, really real. I've seen just enough. I've been tested enough to know now I am convinced He is really real. You see, in Genesis chapter 1, woo-wee. This is let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Now, this first Adam, remember him? Adam, Eve, beginners, initiators, creatures. Here is, look like almost the purpose of God happening, but it's not. Let us make man in our image, in our likeness. Okay? Then he created man. But even in the creation and the forming of man, man was not his purpose. Adam was not his purpose. But now Adam was a part of the process to bring to purpose. That's why the Bible says in the first Adam, all die. Because the purpose of God is not for you to die. I came that you might have life, and that life more. Just for next week, I'm going to come back. I want you to be thinking on this. I'm not going to ask you tonight, but be thinking on this here. You keep hearing that scripture, abundant life. You come to get that you might have life, and that life more abundantly. I want you to just be thinking this week, if you had to ask the question, what is abundant life, and what is that kind of life you're talking about? Where do you find it at? I'm not going to ask you tonight, because that wouldn't be fair, because I know you haven't looked at it. But think about it. If he came that you might have life, and that life more abundantly, have you ever thought or ever considered? Because sometimes we get so caught up in the process of living that we start defining living as life. Right? Because most people think the sole purpose in life is to make a living. And yet they never find life. And yet Jesus said, I come that you might have life, and that life more abundantly. What is abundant life? What is it? Can we look in the Bible and get some type of example of abundant life? What would it look like? If you saw it today, would you know it? I feel so good today. Today, that was in my head. Do I know what it is? No, but I am discovering it though. I don't have all the ins and outs, but I am discovering what abundant life is. It's got to be more than what I had before I came. I need to find something that I didn't have. I can't get but in him. Because you're not going to find abundant life. You can't buy it at Walmart. Not only even a rollback price. Can't get it there. Won't happen. But what happened is that we wonder why today we feel so taxed in our spirit. It's because as long as you live in the first Adam, you're always abounding in death. Don't get me wrong. You're going to be able to operate, but you're going to get wore out doing it. You remember one thing? When at first Adam lost assurance, he started working hard. He was working, bringing fruit in by the sweat of his brow, his face. When you start operating in your first nature, which is the nature of death, when you start operating in that, you can never, ever come to the full purpose of God. When Adam was working, he was in the process. You see, Galatians chapter 4, verse 19, I think I might have to quit with that. Some of these things are so simple, and yet we have made them so complex. But in Galatians chapter 4, I'm gonna start with it, with this anyway. 4:19. Always in the same. Okay, here is Paul. Again, give you a little backdrop of the Galatians church. Again, this church is having multiple issues because most of this Bible in its New Testament, the argument, most of it is about whether or not you're going to accept grace or live under the law of Moses. So here, the Galatians who accepted Jesus one time, I read one place where they said that they didn't mind accepting Jesus as long as they could keep the law too. Well, with God, you can't keep both. You cannot be under Moses and in Jesus too. You're going to either be in one or the other, but you won't straddle the fence. All right? It ain't going to be half and half. You're not going to be in part of it and in part of it. You're going to either be all in or consider yourself all out. You can't be halfway up because halfway up is still down. All right? And so Paul was having a problem because they was having a hard time accepting Paul. But here, in verse 15, where is then the blessing that you speak of? For I bear you record that it had been possible you would have plucked out your eyes and have given them to me. In other words, when they first heard that message, man, they just fell in love. Just everything, just, phew. I mean, they loved it so much. Ain't nothing like the first time I heard the gospel, it felt so good. Like I said, I cried for 2 days. Felt so good. You could have had anything I had that day. If the preacher would ask me for my car, I believe I gave it to him. That's how good I felt. I'm glad he didn't. But it says, am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? It's because he's dealing with fellow brethren that he believed just like they believed. But now with this revelation, he's telling them the truth, and they're angry with him. They zealously affect you, but not well. Yea, they would exclude you that you might affect them. But it's good to be zealous, affected always in good things, and not only when I am present with you. My little children, of whom I travail in birth again, until Christ be formed. What, at the end of the day, what is it that God wants to do? Christ wants to be formed in us. If we're going to bear the image and the likeness, it's because he has been formed in us. So what are we trying to get? We're trying to get a better religion, or we're trying to get Jesus? I mean, I think we ought to go back and look at the purpose of God was that he would be formed in us. And when Christ gets formed in us, we don't have to look for him no more. We should not be asking people, where is our Jesus? If he's been formed, where has he been formed at? Question. Question. Because 99.9% of the people in Moses' day never got a chance to entertain the real presence of God. They had a lot of things going on. You had the best meat cutters in the world. Couldn't nobody cut a sheep like they could. They knew how to catch the blood. They knew how to do all that. They had it down to an art. They knew well. And as far as they were concerned, their whole call was for that one thing, and that was the one thing on. That was their purpose in life, was to learn how to cut a lamb, kill a lamb, chop a lamb, burn a lamb, take ashes out, all that. They perfected. I mean, that was their sole purpose as far as they were concerned. They had no idea that there was a greater purpose. You know, in all that God done, and even in all those types, symbols and shadows and all that kind of stuff, he still had a purpose behind it, because that all was supposed to lead all of them to one place. Guess where they were supposed to lead them to? To lead them to Christ.